all that you've done for us today. We thank you, Lord, for your blessings upon us. Thank you for your goodness in our life. God, I thank you that we can count on you. Hallelujah. God, we praise your name today. Thank you, Lord, for your tremendous mercy in our life, God. Hallelujah. I believe you're going to do something great in this house today. Hallelujah. If you're with family members, if you could just reach out, make contact with someone beside you, and let's pray for one another right now. Lord, I'm asking you to touch my brother, touch my sister. God, I don't know what their need may be today, but I'm asking you to minister to them. I ask, God, that you would be with them, encourage them. Lord, bring healing to their body if they need it. I pray that you would bring healing to their spirit. Help us, Lord, to be what we ought to be. I pray that you would build unity in our church. God, help us, Jesus, to worship you with abandon today. God, we're going to give you the very best that we have, for you have been so good to us, and we worship you this morning. God, I thank you, Lord, for your mercy. Thank you, Jesus, for your goodness, Lord. I'm asking to minister. Hallelujah. Now stretch your hands towards heaven. Let's make a commitment to God. Lord, I dedicate my hands as instruments of praise tonight. God, I'm going to give you the very best hand praise that I can. I'm going to clap my hands. I'm going to lift my hands. I won't be lethargic or lazy, God. I'm going to give you passionate praise with my hands tonight. God, I dedicate my hands as instruments of worship. God, I dedicate my feet now, God. I ask that you would bless, God, the worship of my feet. I will respond. Lord, when others are standing, I will stand. When others are dancing, I will dance, Lord. I'm going to dance to you, Lord, for all of your goodness in our life. I'm going to praise your name in the dance. I'll respond at the altar, God. I'm going to give you the very best praise that I can. Lord, I dedicate my lips to you. I will lift up a loud voice. I will not be subtle. I will not be quiet. But God, I'm going to praise you with a loud voice tonight. For you have been so good to me. And I want the world to know. And I want you to know that I love you. I couldn't have made it here without you. And I thank you, Lord, for your blessings. I'm going to praise you with my lips tonight. In the name of Jesus. God, I'm going to give you the very worship that you deserve. Come on now, for the next 10 seconds, let's give God praise. Open up your mouth and just begin to praise him. We love you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. I just feel to do something right. I don't mean to mess up the flow. I just feel the Holy Ghost wants to give us a breakthrough. Praise team, thank you for being here and being ready to go. But I want us to take just a few more moments to get into the mindset that we need to be. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus, right now. Come on, lift up your voice to the Lord. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Lord God, for what you're doing. God, we're not comfortable with just another service. Lord, just another. God, we need a move of the Holy Ghost tonight. I'm asking you, Lord, let your spirit flow right now. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Make a difference in us, God. Stir us, Lord. Send revival among us, God. We need a move of your spirit. God, stir And now let's lift up our voice and thank him in advance for what he's going to do for us tonight. Lord, I thank you. Come on, make it personal. God, I thank you for the revival you're going to give me tonight. I thank you, Lord, for the healing in my spirit and my mind. God, I thank you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for your goodness, for your blessings, oh Lord. We worship you. Come on, clap your hands to the Lord as you lift up your voice. Come on, lift up your voice. I love you.
Impossible, we've seen our mountains. Somebody lift up that name right now. Lift up the name that's above every name. We bless your name, Jesus.
Oh, the name of Jesus. He is our healer. Call the name of Jesus. He is our provider. So we call the name of Jesus. He is our protector. Call the name of Jesus. He is our deliverer.
Somebody call the name.
Jesus.
He's our protector.
He's our protector.
Call the name
of Jesus. He is our deliverer.
There's no name that is greater, that is stronger. Do y'all believe that tonight? There's no name that is greater, that is than our Savior. There's no name that is greater.
want to be with you. Come on, can we cry that out? Worship him right now. We're not in a rush tonight. On this last Sunday of 2020, I'm not in a rush tonight. God, we just want you to fill this house. You're all that we desire, Jesus. You're all that we want, Jesus. Oh, we need you, Father. Come on, ask him, fill this place.
I said a long time ago, I refuse for us to just go through the motion. I thank God for those that are getting a breakthrough here tonight. Thank you. But I believe God wants to do much more in more people here in this place. And I want us to take just a moment. I'm asking every Holy Ghost filled believer to lift your hands to the Lord. I just feel like God is stretching, yearning to connect with somebody. Hallelujah. We are so filled with the cares of life and all the stuff and trappings of life. I wonder if we could just for a few moments shove all of that aside and call out to Him. Lord, I need revival. Come on, He's reaching for you right now. Just respond to His presence. Lord, I worship You. It. Come on, continue to call out to Him right now. Lord, I love You. Hallelujah. My kingdom must decrease and You must increase. Father, we love You right now. That's it. Make it personal with the Lord. God, I need revival. Father, I need revival. I need revival. Oh, God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, let the Lord rekindle your love for Him right now. Come on, rekindle that love, that passion for God. If my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face. Oh, God, I'm asking You, Lord. God, heal us, Father, I pray. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus, we praise You. Love You, Lord. Come on, let's just wait on the Lord for a few moments. Just continue to talk to Him right now. We need You in this house right now, Father. We need You, oh God. Let Your glory rest upon us. Oh God, I'm asking You to help us. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I realize some may not be comfortable with what's happening right now, but we ought to be. We're the church. Amen. His house of prayer. This is what we're here for, is to commune with the Lord. Hallelujah, Lord, we need You right now, God. Thank you. Let's just wait on the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 My children, come unto me. I call unto you tonight. Come unto me with your burdens. Come unto me with your sin. Come unto me with your heartache and with your pain. And I will give you peace and I will give you relief. My arms are open wide and I have called and yet you do not respond. You are my people. Purchased by my blood. I call you again tonight. I ask for you to come unto me. I am coming soon and will fulfill all that is within the book. I ask tonight that you would respond to me. Reach out to me, for I love you and I long for you. I am coming soon. Now is the time. Reach out unto me, says the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, la 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 Mosaya, la 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 Mosaya. Hallelujah. Come on, let's do that right now. Father, we love you. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Let's just respond just for another few moments. Reach out to him. Father, we love you. We praise you today, Lord. We can't make it without you, Lord. We need you, God. Hallelujah. God, stir every heart of a soul, Lord. God, make a difference in our life. I'm asking, Lord, make a difference, Lord, in this place tonight. Hallelujah. 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 Standing somewhere in the shadows, you'll find Jesus, and he's the only one who cares and understands, standing somewhere in the shadows, you will find him, and you'll know him by the nail prints in his hands. Sing it again. Standing somewhere in the shadows, you'll find Jesus, and he's the only one who cares and understands. Standing somewhere in the shadows, you will find him, and you'll know him by the nail prints in his hands. Amen. Let's just tell him how much we love him tonight. Father, we love you. God, we praise your name. Lord, we worship you. We love you, Lord. God, you're worthy of all the praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. Come on, sing it again. Oh, how I love Jesus. And oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Genesis 2 was a testimony of how God created man. But the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are a testimony of why God made man. He made us for fellowship. He loved us so much that he longed to fellowship with us. Our sin will often separate us from God, but I just want to challenge you. Take advantage of these moments of fellowship with God. He's reaching. Consider the lengths that he's gone to maintain and to care for and to foster a relationship with you and I. Look at all of the work he's done just to spend time with you. Amen. We can take a few moments and spend time with him and set all the world aside and just focus our full attention on the Lord. Amen. Why don't we do that right now? For the next 10, 15 seconds, let's just give God our undivided attention. Lift up our hands and come on, just give him the praise and the adoration that he's worthy of. Father, I love you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen. Amen. I just feel like God's going to do something supernatural in this place tonight. Reaching. Amen. Is there anybody that needs revival? You need revival? After the year that we've had, the church sure could use revival. We need revival in this place. Amen. I've determined that the last few days of this year, I'm going to spend it getting as revived and renewed as possible. Amen. I thank God for what he's doing. Amen. If you love the Lord, clap your hands to him one more time.
You may be seated at this time. It's good to have you at the Pentecostals of Katy on Sunday night. Why don't we take some time right now and welcome all of our online audience, those who are listening by way of Revival Radio and watching online. It's good to have you here tonight. I want to take some time at this part of the service and receive our offering and give you another opportunity to worship the Lord through the giving of your tithes and offering. This time our ushers are making their way through the sanctuary. If you need a contribution envelope, you can lift your hand at this time and they will make sure that you get one of those. You can also give by going to the website and clicking on the giving tab there. And you can also go to my back right, your back left of the sanctuary and give by way of credit or debit card at the kiosk. Amen. While you're getting your contributions ready, we have just a few announcements tonight that we want to go over to make sure that you're in the loop in this busy season of everything that's going on. Our first announcement is that this Thursday, December the 31st, we have two New Year's Eve services that you can be a part of. We have one that will be at 6 p.m. and one that will be at 7:30 p.m. We will be doing communion in both services, and we encourage you to join us as we close this year out. How many of you are ready to tell 2020 goodbye? Come on. I can't think of a better place to do that than here in the house of the Lord. So make sure that you're here at 6 p.m. or at 7:30 this Thursday night. Also, January the 6th, you can sign up in the foyer to be a part of our membership experience. If you want to get to know a little bit more about the Pentecostals of Katy, find a ministry for you or your family. If you've recently joined us, you can join membership experience that will be taking place on January the 6th. If you'd like to sign up for that, you can do that at the Next Steps desk in the foyer. Also, January the 18th through the 22nd, we are going to have our 2021 prayer revival. How many of you enjoy prayer revival? Come on. How many of you are expecting already God to work a miracle during prayer revival? Let's just have a show of hands. Has anybody ever been healed during prayer revival? Has anybody ever received a miracle during prayer revival? Look at the hands across the building. Awesome testimony of God's power and strength. We also want to take a few moments at this time to welcome our guests. We have some first-time guests that are joining us here tonight. And when I call your name, if you'll lift your hands, we want to acknowledge you. First-time guests, Andrew and Jackie Arnold, sitting right here on the left. God bless you. So good to have you with us tonight. We also have a VIP guest with us tonight, second-time visitor, Vanessa and Julie Reyes. Right here in the center section, God bless you. Thank you for joining us tonight. We have some special guests joining us today. Guest of the Furrows, Andy and Bonnie Rodriguez. Sitting right here in the center section, God bless you. Thank you for being with us. Also, we have guest of Sister Annette Reed, Leah Seagraves. Right here in the center section as well, God bless you. And also a guest of the Garcia family, Ingrid Domingue. Right here in the center section. I hope I said that all right. Thank you for joining us. This time, if you'll stand across the building, our ushers are going to begin making their way throughout the congregation, giving you a fly swatter looking high five device. And we want you to take this and make your way around the congregation when we receive our offering. Not right now, but when we receive our offering. If you're missing an iPhone tonight and it's sparkly and has a beautiful flower on it, it has been found and you can come up to the platform and claim that this time. But we're going to pray over our offering and then we're going to put 5 minutes on the clock. We're going to ask you to make your way around the sanctuary and greet all of our guests and greet all your friends and all those that are here tonight. Lift your offering to the Lord right now and let's ask God to bless it. Jesus, God, we thank you for your many blessings. We ask you tonight, Lord, that you would bless the gift and the giver. Lord, use this offering, God, for its intended purpose, God, and bless this church and bless your kingdom, God. And everybody said in Jesus' name, come and bring your offering up to the front.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the Son sets free. Oh, is free.
We're going to get this down. I know this is a little different. We're going to have a better system for it. All right. See, I've only got about half of you right now. Can everybody hear me? Okay. Hello, 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 hello. All right. We're going to have a better system for this next service. I apologize. There's a little bit of confusion. We'll straighten all this out. We'll probably do this a little separately because the praise team's trying to lead us in worship. Folks are giving high fives and all that. So there's just a bit of chaos. Amen. And so if you could take your high five and put it on your chair. All right, there we go. And we'll get back to those in just a minute. Get back to them in just a minute. Amen. I want the praise team to come, and they're going to finish this song. God bless.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me.
Not against me.
Yes, I am.
Say
I am chosen.
Say I am.
Say you are for me.
I am who you say I am.
I am.
You're with me through the fire.
Yeah. those who are in Christ Jesus. If you've been washed in the blood, you can lift your hands and say, I am free. My past is all over. Don't let the devil hang it over your head. You're forgiven, you're washed, and you're clean. Somebody lift your hands and thank the Lord that you've been adopted.
Serve a great God. God has been so good. Thank you, Cher and the praise team, for that song. And now, everybody pick up your high-five device. We don't call them fly swatters. These are high-five social distancing devices. All right. You are in a church. If this looks a little silly to you, you're in a church that loves to greet one another. We love shaking hands. We love letting everybody know we're glad to see them. And we want each of you to know that you're in a friendly church. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to put 5 minutes on the clock. If the AV team could put 5 minutes on the clock. And we're going to give you 5 minutes to walk around. Now, hold on. Everybody look up here real quick. Doctor, could you come? We're going to demonstrate. There are different ways of using these. I know some of y'all were just slapping and it's got really confusing, okay? So first, you can ask somebody to give you five right there. And then they have to give it back, okay? All right. You can also do a high five. That's it. Regular five. You can do a handshake. You can do a back pat. You can do all this within 6 feet of each other. If you really feel anointed, you can lay hands on their head. No, don't do that. If kids are getting out of line, this is your chance. But we want you to take just a few moments and walk around and greet one another and let them know that you're glad to see them in the house of the Lord. To all of our guests that are here, thank you for being here. And come on, get out in the aisle, walk around, give somebody a high five. Social distancing high five. Thank you.
As they come through, just drop them in. They'll sanitize them, get them ready for the next service. Bless you. May be seated. Again, to all of our guests that are here with us this evening, it is an honor to have you. If I haven't met you yet, my name is Rob McKee. I'm the senior pastor here at the Pentecostals, and we're thrilled to have each of you here. Now, I know we did not get very many guest cards. We've got a lot more guests than what we had guest cards for, but we're honored to have you here with us. Great to have a group of guys here from Texas City, Pastor Wedgeworth Church, a longtime friend of ours. Good to have him here. Ashley, good to see you here. Davis, amen. So glad that she's here with us, one of our very own. She's living up on the north side now, but we're glad that she came to the west side tonight. But we are so glad to see everybody. Come on, put your hands together. Let's welcome all of our guests again. Amen. There's nothing quite like the presence of God, gathering together with God's people and worshiping. And I love our POK choir. Thank God for them. And amen. I'm looking forward to what God uses them to bless us with this evening and bless the Lord with this evening, I should say. But why don't you put your hands together and let's welcome the POK choir as they come and minister in song.
These two songs are dedicated to the last Sunday of this year, coming out of 2020 victorious.
For anyone who's ever seen the mountains of their sins just disappear, for anyone who's ever felt the hand of heaven reach down through their fear and dry their tears, or any life that once was empty now finds itself alive in those song calls, victory songs. For them who understand the reason for the way the saints of God may carry on. Troubled days. For anyone who knows they got a future and a hope beyond the grave. Every life's a different story, how he brought us out of darkness into the light.
Clear when I run.
testimony tonight. Hallelujah. I've decided I'm sick and tired of this old world, and I'm ready to go to a better place. But we got to be sold out, our heart fixed, our minds made up. Anybody sold out in this place? This first verse on this song, y'all know this song is called Sold Out. But I want you to think about these words. Who can separate us from the love of Jesus? Not death or life. Nothing can separate us. Jesus paid the price, and I'm free from sin. Another verse says, I've come through the fire, I've come through the rain, but God, He never left my side. He's my comfort. Through all the hurt and pain, that's why I'm sold out. There's no looking back for me. I made up my mind. I made up my mind. Hey. Come on, clap your hands like you mean it.
Anybody sold out in the room tonight? Anybody have their mind made up? Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Yeah. Come to try to convince me there's a better way, you've come too late. I am sold out. There's some bridges that I burned a long time ago. This is the best life. He is the best God. There is no other life that can compare with the life of serving the Lord. My mind is set on heaven. Amen. Thank you, choir. Amen. Amen. Thank God that we have an opportunity to make a decision. The decision can do a whole lot for you. Amen. And we have decided we're going to serve the Lord. There's an old chorus that says, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. Amen. I won't. Y'all know it?
I have decided.
All right. To follow Jesus. You know this chorus? Sing it.
I have decided
to follow Jesus.
To follow Jesus.
I have decided.
I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back.
Amen.
No turning back.
I have decided to follow Jesus.
Well, I have decided
to follow Jesus.
I have decided
to follow Jesus.
No turning back.
Hallelujah. No turning back. Amen. If you haven't made that decision, you can make it tonight. Decide, I'm just going to do it. No matter what happens, no matter what comes my way, I'm going to serve the Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you to the choir and the praise team. I wonder if we could all stand together. Amen. Why don't you come and make that announcement?
Every year we have an annual choir music department meeting, and we welcome new members that are interested in joining the music department. That's happening this January 14th. It's like 2 or 3 weeks away on a Thursday night at 7 o'clock. All you have to do is show up, or you can message me for more details. We got plenty of robes to go around. If not, we'll make up some new ones. We'd love to have some new members in our band, praise team, and choir. So if you're interested in that, just let me know. Thank you.
And that's January
14th.
January the 14th, January the 14th. Write that in your calendar if you're interested. You've been saying, I'm going to do it. Quit making excuses and just do it, and make it happen. Amen. First Corinthians chapter 12, I believe, again. It's repeated again in 2 Corinthians. The Bible talks about different administrations, but the same. They all come by the same Spirit. And It amazes me the different anointings and different ministries that God assembles together. When I was younger, I played the saxophone. I used to have one on the platform, and I'd play it, and then eventually I figured out that I was just getting in the way of the rest of the musicians, so I learned I better stay out of their way. But I am thankful for those that have answered the call of God to play music unto the Lord. And that's a powerful calling, and it's so helpful. Serving in ministry throughout every Sunday, there are people, countless people, that are involved in areas you may not see, from our online streaming all those working on Revival Radio, over half a million listeners around the world, those that are working on our broadcast and media teams. And I appreciate every one of those people that serve. I also appreciate all those that stand in a podium and preach the word. This is not a Rob and Shara show. If you think it is, it's not. This is not a McKee family show, but there are countless people that have answered the call of God and are responsible for what God has done here in this city. And I'm grateful for every volunteer, everyone that has joined in to answer the call of God. Throughout this pandemic, this year, I have, especially during my adventure with Corona, how many had an adventure with Corona? It's okay. There's no shame in it now. Many of us have been there. And during my personal adventure with Corona, there were many ministers who stepped up to the plate and helped and carried the baton. And I really do appreciate every one of them. There was a time when just about everybody was on staff was sick, out sick, and it was just Dr. Wilson and I. But we made it through. We survived it all. I'm just so grateful for the team ministry that God has assembled together. We couldn't do it without all of you. I think we ought to just give them all a great big hand. Amen. And I want them to know how much I appreciate the ministry. The preaching ministry every week is wonderful, top-notch. All the preaching that goes on in preteen with Brother Marshall, of course, in the youth with Brother Gage, in Spanish with Brother Mayer, and, of course, all of the classes that are being taught, all those that were involved in leadership, the leadership class at 9 a.m. every morning, or those in the preachers-only class. I love seeing the variety and the different administrations that God gives to the church. And I've learned to appreciate them. As you know, I love to preach. I do. I really do love to preach. And I've told our folks before, if you're looking for a pulpit, you need to find one, because I love this one. And so it's not easy for me to step away from the podium, but I know that I need it, and we need to hear variety and the plethora of ministries that God has blessed our church with. And last week, of course, we've heard recently from Brother Oryer, who's been teaching on Wednesday nights, and of course, Brother Gage, all of the preachers, our preachers team that we heard last week. Didn't they do a great job last Sunday night? I thought it was fabulous, fabulous. My next preaching assignment will be this coming Thursday night. I'm preaching the last sermon of the year because I want to preach the last sermon of the year. And I'm not going to let anybody else do it. But we're going to have a great service. We'll be receiving communion. And I really feel a special message that God has laid on my heart for the church congregation. And so tonight I have asked one of our favorite preachers to come and minister the word of the Lord. Dr. Wilson is a guest speaker at meetings and conferences all across the United States and around the world. And I appreciate his ministry here and at the local level. He is a friend, and I have enjoyed working with him over the past 4 years, has it been? Almost 5 years. And he has been a blessing to our congregation. And I want you to put your hands together and let's welcome Dr. Eugene Wilson as he comes to minister tonight.
Amen. If you love and appreciate our pastor, would you give him a hand of appreciation right now? Love and appreciate Pastor McKee. Amen. And I want to say, along with everything the pastor was saying, I so thoroughly appreciate and enjoy working with such a great team, and give honor to all of our leaders and all of our ministers, and God bless each and every one of you. I want to go to the word of the Lord in Psalms 23. Most of you could probably quote this, and it's been a while since I have ministered from Psalms chapter 23, But here recently, the Lord has dealt with me concerning a particular portion of this verse of this chapter. Psalms 23, verse 1, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. From verse 5, thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. I want to, by the help of the Lord, to minister on this subject or this title. There is a table. There is a table. Jesus, I pray tonight, God, that the people that are here that are going through some things, God, and are hoping to come out of it, but right now they're in the middle of it. I pray that tonight the word that you have been dealing with me about, God, that I will get out of your way and be able to minister as effective as I can, but you work, you move, you minister, you speak to those hearts and lives. And I give you the praise and glory in Jesus' name. And everyone say amen. 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 You may be seated. When I say the name David, and speaking of a biblical character, and I were to ask you to share with me a story about David, I would surmise that out of this entire audience, the number one story that would be told would be David killing Goliath. And that, at least that would be my story, because that was the first story that I remember hearing when I was a little kid going to Sunday school class. It was David killing Goliath. And as a little guy, I remember thinking to myself, man, maybe one day I can grow up and I can be a giant killer. And so one of my first sermons, I must have been, 18 years old or so, 18, 19, I remember my title, and that is to be a giant killer. And I talked about we need to be a giant killer. And I remember preaching that I want to be a giant killer. But it was here a few months ago that I was just thinking about David and his life. And I was reading the scripture and I was reading his story. And it just dawned on me that his story doesn't start off with David killed the giant. And instead, it starts off that David is out taking care of some sheep, and the prophet Samuel has been instructed by the Lord to go and anoint one of Jesse's sons to be the future king. God had rejected King Saul, and he was going to anoint one of David's sons. And the story begins that the prophet arrived at Jesse's house, and he began to have this conversation with Jesse, and the next thing you know, David's oldest brother is brought before him. And when he's brought before the prophet, one of the first things that the prophet thought was, well, this has got to be the guy. This guy looks like a king. This guy, he has all of the makings of being the future king of Israel. It has to be this guy. And, of course, the Lord spoke to him, and the Lord told the prophet that you're not to look at the outward appearance, because God is looking on the heart. He's looking at something different than what we would see with our natural eyes. And the next thing you know, there is another son brought before the prophet, and no, he's not the one, and then another one, and then Eventually, all seven of Jesse's sons are brought before the prophet, and none of them are the individual that God wants to anoint to be the king. Meanwhile, David is still on the backside of a desert somewhere. He's taking care of sheep, and then all the sons were made to pass before the prophet once again. And once again, the prophet says, no, it's not that one. No, it's not that one. It's not that one. And eventually, the prophet asks Jesse, do you not have another son? So David's story does not begin with David being recognized as this is the guy, and everybody knows that he's the guy, and this is the dude who's going to kill the giant, and this is the guy who's going to become the king of Israel. I mean, this is the guy. Instead, the story starts with a negative. David is forgotten about in the best case scenario. Worst case scenario, his dad does not believe in him. You talk about the lack of affirmation. There seems to be a lot of that in our world today, a lot of a lack of affirmation, perhaps because of all the broken homes, that there is a lack of affirmation. And I don't know why Jesse did not summons David from the field when the prophet arrived, but for whatever the reason, Jesse left David out in the field taking care of sheep while the prophet looked at each and every son that Jesse had besides David, and then looked at all of them again besides David. So it started with the negative, and it seems as though that it doesn't end with the negative in his life, because he's anointed to be the king, but he turns around and he goes right back to taking care of sheep. And then it's a little while later, Jesse summons David from taking care of the sheep and says, I want you to go check on your brothers. And he arrives at a battlefield where Goliath has been challenging the Lord's people. And, of course, they're, hiding in fear. And when David gets there, he begins to question what is going on. And he begins to say, is there not a cause? Is there not a reason? I will go fight. And his brothers begin to question his motives. We're not talking about a stranger question his motives. We're talking about his own brothers. So daddy doesn't believe in him, and neither do his brothers. I just want to pause just here for a second, because there are people in this house here tonight that when it comes to your life and what God wants to do in your life, you know what I am saying when I say that it seems as though that sometimes that there have been some things that God has placed in you that it appears that no one else really recognizes it. And perhaps others even question your motives. And they look at you and they think, well, not that guy. He can't be what he thinks he's supposed to be. And not that lady. She can't really be used of the Lord that way. And they begin to question your motives. So this is what was taking place with David. He is standing before the king, and the king doesn't have anybody to go and fight Goliath. The king is scared, and David begins telling the story. One day there was a lion, came against the sheep. One day a bear killed the lion, killed the bear, and the king decides to allow David to fight Goliath, but he doesn't really believe in him, because he says, well, here, if you're going to go fight Goliath, you need this armor. So he hears the stories about David killing the lion and the bear, but he's not all that impressed, because he's thinking, if you're going to fight Goliath, you definitely need, if you're going to have a chance, you have to have some armor. And he's not impressed with David. And then the story goes on, and you finally have what appears to be somewhat of a positive moment in David's life. He kills the giant and kills Goliath. And then the next thing you know, the people begin to sing the song that Saul has killed his thousands, but David his 10,000s. And David now becomes a hunted man because Saul is filled with jealousy and he's out to destroy David. So here is the guy that should have been his mentor, the guy that should have been pouring into him, the guy that should have been helping him grow and become everything that God wanted him to become, but instead his mentor is now seeking to destroy him. I was sitting at home one day and just reading this passage of scripture in 1 Samuel 16 and David's calling, his anointing, and I began to thinking about David's life, and it really began to dawn on me that we look at David, and again, you know, as a little child, hear my mom tell the stories in the Sunday school class of this great man of God who's greatly used of the Lord. And yet when I read his story, it doesn't start with a positive. It starts with a negative. And then it's one negative after another negative after another negative after another negative. And the next thing you know is that you find four chapters later, 1 Samuel 20, that Jonathan, and this is King Saul's son, is David's best friend. And he tells David, he says, I want you to go and wait by the stone easel. He says, I'm going to shoot three arrows. And I'm going to bring this lad with me, and I'm going to say to this lad, I want you to go and find the arrows. And if I say to this lad, look, the arrows are on this side of you, bring them here, then you will know that you are to come with me, and you are to return to the palace, because the Lord lives and the Lord is at work and you are safe and there is no danger. But if I say to the lad, the arrows are beyond you, then you know that you are to go your way because the Lord has sent you away. Now, you need to understand what that meant for David. If the arrows were beyond the lad, that meant that David was to continue living in a state of adversity, living life on the run, living a life of hardship, living with struggle, living wondering if I'm ever going to make it back home again. Will I ever see my wife again? Will I ever see my kids again? Will I ever get back to what appears to be normal life again? I'm certain that at that moment that David is by the stone easel, that David is thinking to himself, I'm hoping, I'm really hoping, I'm praying that the arrows are going to be on this side and this thing that I am experiencing right now is going to come to an end. The word easel, it actually means the stone of departure, or the stone that shapes or shows the way. It is the stone of destiny. And the stone was that David stood by that day as Jonathan shot the arrows, told David that his destiny was not at this point in time to head to the palace, but instead it was to endure some more suffering. He had been anointed. He had been anointed to ascend. But at this time in the story, there is no ascending. Instead, David would have to go back to waiting on the fulfillment of his anointing. I believe that I am speaking to at least a few people in this place tonight, that you have been anointed and yet you wait. As I was looking at this story, the Lord began dealing with me and speaking to me, because there is a wait team that is simply that of abiding time. It's just waiting. But when I look at David's waiting, it wasn't just waiting as in abiding time. David's waiting was about a struggle. It was about things not ending as quickly as he thought it was going to end, speaking of the struggle, but it would continue. I know that most of us here, we were hoping and thinking that COVID was going to end at the election. And here we wait. And of course, we're Texans, and I tell everybody that. We're Texans. They're like, what are you doing? I said, we're Texans, man. We're not Californians. Thank God for Texas. But you know, J.T. Pugh said something years ago. I've never forgotten it. J.T. Pugh said that many times what is happening in the natural realm is just simply a manifestation of what is taking place in the spiritual realm. We'll say that again. Many times what's taking place in the natural realm is a manifestation of what is taking place in the spiritual realm. And so in the spiritual realm, it shouldn't be a surprise that for some, there is a battle against fear. And it shouldn't be a surprise that in the spiritual realm, that for some, there is a wait that is continuing longer than what some of us expected. David, he knew what it was like to wait, but not just in abiding time, but to wait in the midst of trouble. And it's years later, Spurgeon's not the Lord, but Spurgeon believed this, and many others believe it too, that it was years later, while David was the king of Israel, that David writes, as he reflects back over his life, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, these are tools used by the shepherd. They comfort me. And he uses this allegory of a shepherd. And this is something that David, he knew this very well, because he had once been a shepherd. And then he changes allegories, and he writes in verse 5, thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. He's already established that even though I walk through the valley, I'm not going to be afraid, because you are with me. That is thinking about the Lord being the shepherd. I'm not going to be afraid, because the good shepherd is with me, and the good shepherd has a rod and a staff, and they comfort me. And then all of a sudden, he shifts allegories, and now it is as though that he is picturing God as a military leader. He's big enough, he's strong enough, he's bad enough, that even though that you are surrounded by enemies, God is able to say, hey, I'm going to stop everything right for a moment. I've got a table spread here. I want you to sit right down here at this table, and in the presence of your enemies, take a moment of rest. There's nothing hasty about this picture that David is painting with words. Because if you are a soldier, and I've been reading some books last couple weeks dealing with military men and snipers, and it's very interesting. And I know that if you're as a soldier and you're in the midst of a battle, you don't really have much time to eat. If you do eat, you are going to eat very quickly. You're going to grab it, and you're going to run, and you're going to eat on the run. But David writes that there's enemy all around, and God says, I just want you to take a break. I'll take care of the enemy. I don't want you to worry about him. Here, sit down. Enjoy the moment. Anybody in this place here tonight, you know what I mean when I say there are times that you should be stressed out, but you just had a little talk with Jesus. Yeah. The times that you should be filled with worry, but you just had a little bit of a praise break. Times when you should have been filled with anxiety, but you're driving down the road and you're just looking at the sun as it sets and you're thinking about the goodness of the Lord, and all of a sudden God's presence just sweeps into your automobile, and before you know it, you're pulled over the side of the road with tears running down your face and you're just having a God moment. Anybody know what I'm talking about right now? It should have been that you were up all night long worrying, but that night you just took a little bit of a moment and you grabbed the Word of God and you begin to read, and there was just something in the Word of God that just jumped from the pages, and you knew at that moment, I've got a word from God. I can lay my head down tonight. I can go to sleep and I can get peace. I can have a moment of rest. That's what I'm preaching about here tonight. I don't have the most encouraging word for some of you, but I do. I don't, and I do. Thank you, Brother Tim. He's preaching with me. Here's the part that I don't really have a most encouraging word. I can't promise you that what you're going through is going to end anytime soon. I wish I could tell you that the struggle is going to end at the end of 2020, but I know that the end of 2020 is just the end of a calendar. It's not necessarily the end of the struggle that you are in, because some of you are going to continue into 2021 with a struggle. And I'm sorry, that's not the most encouraging word for some of you tonight. And I know for some of you, you went into 2020 thinking about things are going to change in 2020, but in 2020, you went through more stuff than you've ever experienced in your life. And I'm here to tell you tonight that, you know, it may not just end the end of 2020. It may be tough in 2021 too. I know some of you are looking at things with your bank account, and some of you are looking at things with your relationships, and some of you are looking at things with on your job, and some of you are looking at things with ministry, and the list goes on, and you're thinking that, you know what, it's got to be next year. It wasn't this year, but it's got to be next year. But I've come with not so encouraging word, because it may be that God directs the arrow to go beyond. And for you, maybe not for everybody, but for you, it's more struggle. That's the not so encouraging word. But here is the encouraging word. It came from a man who went back to the wilderness. More struggle. As he's thinking back on it, because he remembers the time. Thou preparest a table before me in the midst of my struggle, in the midst of my trouble, in the midst of my adversity. There is a table. So I do have an encouraging word. I have a word of instruction. Because if all you're trying to do is simply abide time, it may be that your abiding time is going to be a whole lot more struggle than what you ever anticipated. But if you will participate, if you will engage with the table that God prepares for you, amen. Anyone know where I'm going at this right now? If you will participate with the table that God prepares for you in the presence of your enemies, in the midst of your struggle, you're going to get enough to get you through. You're going to get enough rest. You're going to get enough nourishment. You're going to get enough to get you through if you'll participate with what God has prepared on the table. What does that look like in practical terms? I'm going to be as practical as I can be. What does that look like in practical terms? Practical terms, that means that when you walk into the house of the Lord and we're singing and we're praising and we're magnifying the name of the Lord, that is a table that has been prepared in the presence of your enemies. If you'll engage with lifted hands and lifted voice, magnifying him, not just singing a song, but magnifying him. You've got a little moment. You got a little reprieve. You got a little moment that you can participate with the table that he has spread before you in the presence of your enemies. That means, as we experienced earlier in the service, there were a lot of people engaging with what was taking place. That means that, you know what? I'm not just waiting for it to go away, because it may not go away, but I'm going to make sure I participate in this right now. This may be my moment to sit at the table. I couldn't help but think about this. David was anointed, and yet there was a wilderness. He was anointed, and yet he was forgotten about. He was anointed, and yet he was mocked. He was anointed, but his integrity was questioned. He was anointed, but others could not see what he had to offer. He was anointed, but Saul was trying to destroy him. He was anointed, but he had to endure hardship and struggle. And you're thinking, I thought I was anointed. What did you expect? Did you think that because of an anointing you would never go through anything? If so, you're mistaken. An anointing on your life means that God will allow you to go through some things so that he can make you into the man or the woman that you need to be to fulfill the anointing on your life. And some of you are looking at the fact that, well, my daddy didn't affirm me. My brothers and sisters, they questioned me. And some of you are struggling with some things that you shouldn't have been beyond a long time ago. Why? Because there's an anointing on your life. And yes, you've been in a season of waiting. And yes, you may go through a little bit more weight. But it's okay, because he's prepared you a table. Musicians will come. I have shared this story before, but it always grabs me. I can't help but share it again. Mr. Spafford, he experienced a lot of negative things first two were the death of his four-year-old son. And then there was the Great Chicago Fire in 1871. It ruined him financially. He had been a very successful lawyer. He invested a significant amount of money into property. And it just so happened to be that it was in the area of Chicago that was damaged by the Great Fire. And then 2 years later, he planned a trip to England to be with his family. And his intention was to help D.L. Moody with an evangelistic campaign in England. He was a God-fearing man. The last minute, his plans changed. There were some business matters to dealing with the zoning problems in Chicago after the Great Fire. So he sent his family on ahead with plans to join them soon. But it was while they were crossing the Atlantic Ocean that the ship that was carrying his wife and his four daughters, they had an accident with another ship, and four of his daughters drowned in the ocean. He received a telegram from his wife, and it simply read, "Saved alone." Afterwards, he boarded a ship and he traveled to meet his grieving wife. As they were passing the area where his daughters had died, he had asked the captain, "Would you point out the area when we pass through those waters?" And the captain had told him. And as they were passing through those areas where his daughters had perished, he began to write, "When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to know, it is well with my soul." And then his chorus, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul. Could I just say to somebody here tonight, I know this is a little different. I have felt this message for so long now. It's been several months. Could I just tell somebody here tonight, it won't always be this way. It won't always be that you're in the struggle that you're in right now. It won't always be this way. But for now, can you declare right now, it is well with my soul? Because if you can, that means you know what it's like to sit at the table that he's prepared for you in the presence of your enemies. Can you say, truly say, it is well with my soul? Isaiah writes, "Every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill shall be made low. And the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough places plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. For the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it." Every valley, would you say, in my life with me? Every valley in my life shall be exalted, and the crooked places in my life. Would you say it? The crooked places. Would you stand with me? Every valley, I want us all to say it, in my life. Every valley in my life shall be exalted. The crooked places in my life shall be made straight. And the rough places in my life shall be made smooth. And the glory of the Lord will be revealed to me. Because the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. I look out across this audience and I'm so tempted to start calling names, telling your stories. I'm not going to do that tonight. But every valley in your life shall be exalted. Amen. I said every valley in your life shall be exalted. The crooked places in your life shall be made straight. The rough places shall be made smooth. the glory of the Lord shall be revealed to you. I believe that. Do you believe it? But for now, it may be that for some of you, I'm sorry, but for some of you, it may be that the valley may be a little rough still. But it's okay, because he's prepared a table. I said, it's okay, because he's prepared you a table. I'll tell you what I feel right now in the Holy Ghost. I feel that the Lord is challenging some people in this place for you to quit, for you to stop trying to fill your life up with other things so you can dull the pain, and for you to embrace a table that is prepared for you right in the presence of your enemies. Stop running. Stop fighting. Stop trying to fill your life up with everything else. Stop trying to push away from the table, and instead embrace the table that is prepared for you in the presence of your enemies. In the name of Jesus. God, I know that you're speaking to people in this place right now. God, I know you're speaking to people in this place right now. God, I pray that there are people tonight, before they leave this place, God, that they will pull up a chair and they'll sit down at the table that you have prepared for them in the presence of their enemies. Tonight, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Is there anybody in this place tonight? Is there anybody in this place that says, you know what? I think I want to spend a little time sitting at the table that he's prepared for me in the presence of my enemies, right in the midst of my struggle. I want to spend some time sitting at the table. If that's you, would you come right now? Would you come to the table? There's a table that's prepared. Would you come? There's a table that's prepared for you. There's a table prepared for you. There is a table prepared for you. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, there's a table prepared for you.
You know my name. You know my name. You know my name. You know my name. You know. And oh, how you walk with me. And oh, how you talk with me. And oh, how you tell me.
Oh, how. friendship.
Oh, how you talk with me.
Oh, how you tell me.
Oh, how you tell me.
I belong to you, Lord.
I am your own.
Oh, we love you, Lord. You know me, Jesus. Oh,
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Dr. Wilson, for reminding us the importance of taking time to be renewed. I want you to know God wants you to be sustained. It's not the will of God that we deal with problems the way that we often do. We try to handle it on our own. We don't take time. Slow down and take time for fellowship with the Lord. I mean, even Jesus himself exampled this. All the Gospels mention the Passover meal, but I think it's Luke 22 where Jesus said, he said, with great desire, I've desired to have this Passover meal with you before my suffering. Sometimes you don't know what tomorrow holds. And so he wanted to take a little break right in the middle of affliction while all of the soldiers were gathering their troops to come and arrest him. He took a little break right in the middle of it all. He said, with great desire, I just wanted to have this moment with you. Shut the world out before the trouble, before the crucifixion. Just have this time. Sometimes our trouble is not the divine plan of God like Calvary was. Sometimes our trouble is self-inflicted. Reminded of 1 Kings 25 when the prophet Elijah was running from Jezebel, and he's on the run for his life, and he falls down and says, you know, I just want to die. I shouldn't even be alive. And in that moment, he falls asleep and he wakens, and there's an angel of the Lord that's prepared a meal for him. There's coals at his head. The angel tells him, the journey before you is great, and you need to get up and eat. Now, keep in mind, his trouble was self-inflicted. He was on the run because of his own fear and anxiety. He wasn't on some divine mission. He had done this to himself, and yet God cared enough about him that said, right in the middle of this self-inflicted trouble you put yourself into, you need to have a little bit of a break because I care about you and I want to provide for you. I love you and I want to take care of you. You know, the dangers of not taking time for the Lord, you know, you could actually find it in Genesis 25. The Bible talks about Jacob and Esau. And Esau is a mighty hunter. He's loved by his father Isaac. But he comes in because he didn't take time to eat, didn't take time to, you know, to find nourishment for himself. He ended up losing his birthright in a moment of temptation. He sold his birthright because he sat down at the wrong table. And when we don't take time to sit down at his table, we're going to find a table to sit down at and try to satisfy our needs and our desire. We better be careful that we don't lose things that God intended us to hold on to. Amen. Make sure that you take time. Spend it with the Lord. You need this renewal that's happening tonight. We need this. You need this. I know we're task-driven. By personality, I'm a task-driven person. I like to check things off my list. It's what makes me feel like I've had a good day. But in spite of all of the tasks, there's nothing more important than slowing down, setting my task list aside, and just spending time in his presence. It doesn't seem like you're getting much, but one day, if you ignore it, you'll learn the value of taking time for him. If you ignore it, you'll sit down at a different table. Amen. And we need to make sure that we're being replenished and renewed at his table and not at the table of vices, the cares of life. Well, I just need a break. So you sit down in front of a TV and watch 2 or 3 hours of mindless garbage, just trying to feed something. That's not the way
that God intended us to be renewed, we need to take time to spend it with Him. Amen. I wonder if we could just lift our hands and let's make a commitment tonight. Lord, starting this week, I'm going to take time for You just to spend in Your presence. Come on, let's tell Him right now. Lord Jesus, God, I commit my life to be a person of prayer. To slow down, God. Slow down and spend time in Your presence. Just like earthly fathers desire for their children to spend time with them. Lord, I know that that's Your desire for me, to spend time with me. Lord, help me, God, to slow down and fellowship with You. Hallelujah, Jesus. I love You, Lord. I love You, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Spend time in Your presence. That's all I want, Lord. Spend time at Your table. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Amen. 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 There's nothing like the table that God prepares for His children. Nothing like it. Doesn't matter where you're from. Doesn't matter how messed up your life is. It's 1 Samuel, I believe it's 25, 26, when David becomes king. And he sits on the throne and he asks the question, are there any left of the household of Saul that I might show forth kindness upon them? And Ziba, one of the servants of Saul, says, there remaineth yet a son of Jonathan, Mephibosheth by name, and he lives in the place called Lodibar. And David sends Ziba out to fetch him, like a dog picks him up. And Mephibosheth had been injured as a child because they assumed David would slaughter all the king's kids when he became king. But the nursemaid ran out of the house and dropped Mephibosheth. And he was injured and lame in his legs all of his life. And sometimes, you know, when we come to the Lord, we're dealing with injury that other people caused. And we're struggling with it all of our life because somebody dropped us, somebody disappointed us. And bringing all of those, all of that dysfunction into the kingdom of the Lord. And Ziba lays Mephibosheth down at the feet of David. And Mephibosheth asks the question, why would you even pay attention to a dog like me? I'm nothing. But David tells him, listen, from now on, you're going to sit at the king's table. I thought that was a beautiful picture of what the Lord has done for us. Because when he sat down at the king's table, on one side he's got wise Solomon. On the other side he's got Absalom in his handsomeness and all of his strength. Sitting around the table are all the rulers and the king's royal guard. And there sits Mephibosheth. And all of his twisted brokenness, messed up past, it's all hidden under the king's table. I'm thankful that God loves us enough that we can come together and just spend time with Him, spend time with the King. Are you glad you got an audience with the King today? Thank you, Dr. Wilson. Come on, let's lift our hands and just thank the Lord once again. Father, we thank You that You love us enough that You would fellowship with us. I pray that You would help us to apply this message. Don't let us just be a hearer, but Lord, let us be a doer of the Word to make a difference starting tomorrow, that I determine I'm going to do whatever it takes, get up earlier, take time, take my lunch break, whatever it takes, God, I'm going to carve out time to fellowship with You every day of my life. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Again, to all of our guests that are here with us tonight, before we dismiss, I just want to tell you how much I appreciate you being here. If you're looking for a home church, again, congratulations, you found it. But we encourage you to come back and be with us again. Remember, this coming week, no Wednesday service. Service is moved to Thursday night. Everybody be here Thursday night for our New Year's service. I'll be preaching 6 and 7:30, and we're going to be receiving communion. Let's prepare our hearts and minds. God bless you. You're dismissed in the fear of the Lord.